And artificial intelligence has been reshaping industries, but it's also widening the gap for cyber threats. While 80% of companies have already adopted AI, only 6% of them have a security strategy to protect it. That's according to SandboxAQ. And now, at one of the world's largest tech events, GITEX, we have our next guest to discuss why the region has a once-in-a-generation opportunity to shift from being a consumer of AI to a creator of transformative IP. Very pleased to welcome back to Access Middle East, Jack Hidary. He's the CEO of SandboxAQ, which is, of course, backed by NVIDIA. Thank you very much. Jack, welcome to the program. Great to have you with us. Of course, joining us from the GITEX conference in Dubai. First of all, I know it's still early morning, but you've been on the ground for a couple of days now. What's the energy like this year, and how does the conversation around AI here compare to what you're hearing in the US and Europe right now?
Well, Dan, very good to see you. We're live here from the floor of GITEX in Dubai. More than 200,000 people will be visiting this week, this conference. So a lot of good energy the last 2 days, but also concern. As you just mentioned in your opening notes, AI is transforming lots of industries, but also creating a bigger attack surface for cyber hackers. And so while AI does help in many areas, it also exposes vulnerabilities in the companies using it. As you mentioned in our SandboxAQ survey, wide adoption of AI, more than 80% of large enterprises now have adopted it. But it's also the number one concern of more than 75% of CISOs and security leaders, the concern about how do they secure the use of AI and also defend against AI attacks. So this is a big concern. We're actually sitting in a part of GITEX now with many of the cyber companies around, and it's definitely on people's minds as they look to the future.
Absolutely. It's one of the big themes at GITEX this year. AI and cybersecurity, of course, very closely correlated. Let me take you back to something you just said. Jack, you said AI creates a much bigger attack surface for companies. Explain to me what that means in layman terms, and can you give me a real-world example?
Sure. So in the days before AI, we knew about an attack called SQL injection. And what that means is if you're accessing a database in a big company, and maybe you have access to it from a website so that you can look up information, you can inject hacking information into the database by putting something in that search box. Well, now fast forward to the prompt box that we're all familiar with the large language models, and we now have a new attack called a prompt injection. And so an attacker can use that prompt box that we're all familiar with and put nefarious malware through that prompt box into the large language model. That's one kind of attack. A second kind of attack exposes the information of the company to others. And so if you don't have the right guardrails around the use of AI in your company, if you're using an AI that, say, is using that data for training for everyone else to use, that means your proprietary info, your trade secrets in your company will now be accessible by the entire world. That was a real world case, Dan, in the case of Samsung, where early on, when we say early, we mean a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, Samsung engineers put some information in as a prompt, but it revealed some proprietary information from the company. And so security leaders across the global 1000 are really concerned about these kinds of attacks. AI, very helpful tool, but exposing new vulnerabilities in large companies.
Right, so what can the C-suite do? What can executives within the technology and AI space actually do to ensure that large firms, big companies are protected from some of these vulnerabilities?
Well, the thing to do is, one, to make sure that if you're using one of the paid-for models, be it OpenAI or Google Gemini or Anthropic, that you make sure you have the enterprise edition that cordons off your information away from the training data set. Number two, another way to go, for example, Bank of America and others decided to use an open source version of large language models, download it locally, and run it locally in their own data centers to ensure that they had a good firewall around that. So there's different approaches, but the key is that only 6% of large enterprises even have a plan, Dan, as to how they're going to protect themselves from these new vulnerabilities. What we're also seeing, Dan, at GITEX is an increased focus on NVIDIA, on other chip manufacturers, and how they're transforming what will be the next wave of AI.
Indeed. So, look, let's take a step back and also talk about what we're seeing in the Middle East right now as well, because, Jack, I know you follow this really closely, as I do as well. Over the last couple of years, we've seen this region attract some really serious investment into the AI infrastructure layer in particular, with the likes of NVIDIA, as you mentioned, AMD as well, all backed by sovereign capital too. So what's your pulse check on the region right now? How do you see this region reshaping global compute capacity? And are you seeing anything that's giving you perhaps pause for thought or maybe even concern?
Well, I think that let's first look at the physical infrastructure. You're seeing a huge amount, billions of dollars being invested by G42 here in the UAE, by Humane, which is a new AI organization in Saudi. We're seeing these organizations put billions of dollars into the infrastructure. So that's happening at a really good pace. What I think is an opportunity, a big one here in the Gulf region specifically, is on the data layer. When you look at large language models, of course, the data is the World Wide Web. Recently, Tim Berners-Lee, the creator of the web, came out with his book, This is for Everyone. And we use that for large language models as the training set. But there's a key opportunity that I think is before us here in the Middle East, here in the Gulf region, and that is to focus on applications in creating new biotech assets, new chemistry, new materials, new kinds of batteries. This region is very intense in terms of its energy usage and energy production. And they need a new kind of AI that is not just large language models, but now what you see being adopted in the Gulf is large quantitative models to take hydrocarbons, for example, make new kinds of products from it. When we look at biotech, we look at 400 million people in this region, key health challenges. And so using AI to develop new therapeutics, new diagnostics, that means we've got to go beyond the World Wide Web, and we've got to create new data sets that really address those kinds of issues. Going from a resource-intense economy to an IP-focused economy is one of the key things that you see the governments here focused on.
Indeed, Jack, and the region really trying to build proprietary compute and data algorithms here in the Gulf. But, you know, I speak to executives in this space. One of the key concerns I continue to hear is that while there's deep pools of public and private capital to facilitate all of this, they don't necessarily have the talent on the ground in order to execute it. Is the talent gap still an issue in this part of the world?
Well, I think it's a big opportunity. When you look at what's happening in the UAE, in Bahrain, in Saudi, in Kuwait, in other countries, there's an increased focus on where will the talent come from. For more than 10 years now, there's been NYU in Abu Dhabi as an example. There's KAUST in Saudi. There's other organizations. Also in UAE's MBZ UAI, which is a dedicated university just for AI. So there's definitely been an increased focus the last 4 or 5 years on this issue. I do think that we're going to have to see more partnerships with international organizations, international universities, and the governments here. So I think we're just seeing the beginning of that, because there's definitely going to be a need for more and more talent, not just in terms of AI engineers, not just coders, but also what we call bilinguals then. A bilingual, for example, is somebody who knows medicine, knows biology, and knows AI. Somebody who knows chemistry and energy and knows AI. We call those folks bilinguals, and they're very rare. They're like unicorns, but we're going to need more and more of them here in the Gulf region to transform the key industries. And finally, I would say there's a strong desire here in the Gulf to diversify the economies. Energy is a strong component, always will be, but looking for biotech specifically, looking for new areas to expand the opportunities here in the Gulf, that will require new kinds of talent.
So, Jack, just on that point, what would you say is the biggest headwind or the biggest challenge for this region right now when it comes to these AI ambitions that you're outlining?
Well, I would say that the region is making really strong progress to make partnerships and ties. Every few weeks, we see another partnership of an entity here in the Gulf with one of the global entities. It might be Microsoft, it might be Google, it might be NVIDIA, AMD, and many others. So we're seeing more and more of those partnerships. That's going to be a key way to accelerate the development here in the Gulf. We also want to see more IP owned in the Gulf. That's one of the key challenges, I would say. Right now, 90%+ of the IP in the AI space is being created in only 4 countries in the world. We want to see that expand. And I think the Gulf region can be one of those key regions that not only uses IP from the rest of the world, but also is creating that IP here. I think that's one of the key opportunities right now.
Jack, I wish we had more time, but we'll have to leave it there. Really appreciate the conversation. Thanks so much for joining us live on the ground at GITEX this year. Looking forward to seeing you soon. That's Jack Hidary there from SandboxAQ. Thanks again.